The rise of communism in Russia and China inspired many African post-independence leaders. One of those leaders inspired was Ali Swahili. Born in Madagascar, he would launch a revolution in Comoros Island and depose its leader and introduce one of the most radical Maoist socialist reforms to grace the African continent. On today's African History 101, we're looking to Ali Swahili, Mao Zedong's African copycat. Ali Swahili was born in 1937 in Majunga, in Madagascar, where he spent most of his childhood before traveling to France to continue his studies. During the 1960s, he moved to Comoros in order to work as an agronomist. Everything changed in 1970 when he entered the world of politics. During this time, the island of Comoros was under French rule. Ali Swahili supported Said Ibrahim, leader of the Democratic Assembly of Comoran People. Ali would develop a strong sense of resentment against the French. In July 1975, Comoros declared independence, with Ahmed Abdallah as the president. But like most African countries, political instability plagued the young nation. Just 2 months after being in power, Abdallah was deposed in a coup assisted by French mercenary Colonel Bob Denard and replaced by Prince Said Muhammad Jaffa. Prince Said Muhammad Jaffa's reign would not survive long and was replaced by Ali Swahili in another coup. Ali Swahili became the head of the Revolutionary Council that took power in the Comoros Island. Once in power, Ali Swahili wanted to turn Comoros Island into a mini China. He adopted the Maoist socialist policies. After more than 130 years of French rule, colonial education had left the people more cautious of the French history and culture than their own. Indeed, the bulk of the population, including the educated class, was like the proverbial frog in the well, in which they believed the sky was as big as the well. For them, the world was France. Ali Swahili removed French as the official language, preferring to the native Shingazija language. To spread his revolutionary rhetoric, Ali Swahili controlled the radio as a way of spreading his political propaganda. It is said that Ali Swahili dictated every content aired on the radio. To see if the programs were exactly as he wanted, Ali Swahili would sometimes glue to the radio for hours for constant check of the radio presentation. During this time, every word that was said on the radio was like listening to the president himself speaking. Ali Swahili also changed the country's alphabet to Latin from Arabic. This meant that everybody had to go back to classroom to learn how to read and write. Again, if you think that only the peasantry was subjected to this change, you are wrong. The government youth wing, the Moise, would drag the top government officials to attend these classes. Condemned as wasteful and cumbersome, certain inherited customs of the Comoran culture were abolished, like the anda, the traditional grand marriage, as well as the traditional funeral ceremonies, which were criticized for being too costly. So he advanced the cause of the youth by discouraging the study of history and allowing young people to take more power. In order to reach his goal, he lowered the voting age to 14 and put teenagers in position of responsibility. Among the most striking of his reforms were measures designed to gain favor with the youth, like the legalization of cannabis, promoting the removal of veil among women of Comoros. Following the rule book from his idol, Mao Zedong, he formed a group of young idealists who were only loyal to himself. Just like the Red Guard during the Chinese Cultural Revolution, Ali Swahili named his group the Moise. The Moise were infamous for their brutality in Comoros Island. Moise units terrorized villages and specialized violent attacks against conservative elders, former revered old men. The Moise were viewed by the Comorian people as a repressive political police, and their intimidation tactics and often random and chaotic activity caused widespread resentment among the Comorian population. The teenage Moise were armed with AK-47 assault rifles and behaved with outrageous arrogance, raping any woman who resisted their advances and killing anyone who questioned their authority in the slightest. The commander of the Moise was a 15-year-old boy chosen only for his loyalty to the president. The humiliation of the Comorian people at the hands of the Moise and the undermining of the authority estranged the traditional leaders of the Comoros, who resented the progressive elimination of age-old traditions. Growing discontent promoted by the political opposition resulted in 4 unsuccessful coup attempts against the Swahili regime during its 2.5-year existence. As a result of the Swahili's confrontational policies, France, the former colonial power in the island, terminated all aid and technical assistance programs to Comoros after the withdrawal of the French financial subsidies. The treasury was soon emptied. In a move having budgetary as well as ideological implications, some 3,500 civil servants were dismissed in 1977. Swahili made a more than symbolic break with the past in 1976 by burning French government archives, which had been kept since the acquisition of the Mahore 135 years before. Swahili, who described himself as a devout Muslim, advocated a secular state and limitations on the privileges of the Muftis and the Muslim jurists who interpreted the Islamic law. These reforms, which were perceived as attack on the Comorian traditions, combined with deepening economic crisis, eroded support for his government. Several attempts were made on Swahili's life, and in a referendum held in October 1977, only 55% of the voters supported a new constitution proposed by Ali Swahili's government. Attacks by the Moise on real and imaginary political opponents escalated. Raids on mosques were common. A number of refugees fled to Mahore. The eruption of Karatara in April 1977 and the influx of refugees from Madagascar following a massacre of resident Comoreans there exacerbated the situation. In March 1978, some fishers in the town of Ikoni, south of the Maroni, were killed after protesting the government's policy on compulsory sale of their catch to the state. Severe food shortages in 1976-1977 required the government to seek international aid and forced the young nation to divert its already limited export earnings from economic development to purchase of rice and other staples. With his support at its lowest, Ali Swahili's enemies conspired to depose him. On May 13, 1978, Swahili was overthrown by a 50-member mercenary unit, largely former French paratroopers hired by exiled former leader Ahmed Abdallah and led by French Colonel Bob Denard. The Moise were worthless as soldiers, and the French mercenary almost effortlessly annihilated the Moise in a few hours of the fighting, as the untrained and disciplined rabble of the Moise, who had never seen action before, were no match for the well-trained and experienced French mercenaries, most of whom were veterans of the elite parachute unit. In few hours of fighting, French killed hundreds of the Moise without losing a single man in return. On the night of the coup, Swahili was discovered by Denard, who kicked in the door to his bedroom. Ali Swahili was found naked in his bed with 3 teenage schoolgirls. All of them were high on marijuana, watching a pornographic film. Denard recalled that Swahili was so stupid and high that he had to repeat several times his message that he was no longer president before Swahili finally realized that he was now deposed. Abdallah became president, Swahili's policies were reversed, and the name of the country was changed to Islamic Federal Republic of the Comoros. On May 29, Swahili was shot and killed. According to the government, he had attempted to escape from his house arrest. Thanks for watching today's History 101, where we looked into the life of Ali Suhail. Please leave your comment on the regime of Ali Suhail in the comment box below.